Okay, everybody, here we are, man, back again. This is CCR, their seventh studio album, side two of Mardi Gras. Side one was very, very good. honestly, definitely not as good as previous albums, but still a pretty damn good album. I think one of the things that's probably hurt it just slightly is the addition of the other lead vocals in the form of the other band members. In one hand, it's really, really good to kind of give them their due. On the other hand, though, I immediately kind of missed the vocals of and the familiarity of John Fogerty. But hey, man, you know, you gotta have an open mind. So I'm gonna enter into side two with a bit of an open mind. So let's check this out, man. Mardi Gras, side two. Let's get it.
When you're alone, come back crying and you wanna go home. The sun I'm forgetting, it seems like you're letting it take you away from me. Girl, I did it, pack up and go. Said you had.
try to sail away from the rest of my life. Mark. Yeah, I've heard that before. Good tune. That song in a long time, man. Sweet Hitchhiker. Yet again, this whole CCR thing, discovering or remembering rather, songs that I had long since forgotten, songs that I might not have necessarily known was covered by CCR, but that I had heard at some point in time. And, you know, and then now it's come full circle. I'm making that connection and I realize, oh man, yeah, yeah, this was done by them. This was done by them. So lots of, rediscovering along the way, pleasant surprises. Wow, man. 4 years of, and 7 albums and lots of fantastic, fantastic songs. Yeah, this album here, I would definitely give it a B+. And hey, you know what? I'm gonna keep it real. And some of you are gonna hate me for saying it, but I think that the presence of the other voices hindered this album a little bit. If you were to have taken John's voice to sing those particular songs, perhaps it might have given it a little bit more elevation. But overall, I think for me, the presence of the other voices hurt the album's final grade. That's all I'm going to say about that. Now, having said that, I like the album. I would listen to it again. I wouldn't skip the songs, but I definitely do like more the John Fogerty vocals on this album rather than the others. But hey, you know what? When you're a group, when you're a band, it's great to actually give the other members, you know, their time in the sun, give them time to stretch their creative wings and to allow them a platform to launch themselves as well, you know. So, hey, it shouldn't always be about John, and I'm glad to see that it wasn't entirely about John. I got more to say about that, though. I have a certain, I don't know, attitude about that sort of thing. And I'm sure that I'm going to get some good smacks about it. But I'll cross that bridge when I get there. So for now, man, I just want to do a little background on this seventh and final album. So now this concludes side two of my reaction. And I'm separating side two from the review. And a lot of you already know why, so I won't get into explaining again. But this is the end of side two. So let's go into the review portion right now, man. And I've got my Wikipedia up. And let's find out a little bit of background on this seventh and final CCR album. Mardi Gras. Mardi Gras is the seventh and final studio album by American band Creedence Clearwater Revival, released April 11, 1972. Recorded after the departure of guitarist Tom Fogerty, it was their only album as a trio. The group disbanded after this album was released. Overview. Unlike previous albums, Mardi Gras had Stu Cook and Doug Clifford sharing songwriting and production with John Fogerty, as well as their own lead vocal contributions for the first time. Reviews were mixed to poor, with John Landau stating in his Rolling Stone review that the album may be known in the future as Fogerty's Revenge. Wow. I take it he wasn't a fan of this album. Following the album's release, the group was officially dissolved on October 16th of 72 in a statement released by the group and its record label, Fantasy Records. Mardi Gras is the only album by the band that was not remastered and reissued until the 40th anniversary of their formation in 2008. Production. Previously, band leader John Fogerty sang all lead vocals, created the song arrangements, and composed all the band's original material. Older brother Tom Fogerty had departed after a dispute, which was in large part caused by his desire to play a larger creative role, and John's insistence on being the band's only singer, songwriter, business manager. Yeah, man. Definitely a recipe for strife and conflict there. It's like you're being suppressed. You want to do more, you want to contribute more, but you've got a bigger, larger entity trying to keep you suppressed. So I'm seeing Tom's point of view here, but I'm also seeing John's point of view here. John's point of view is like, okay, listen, man, we have a brand. We have a winning formula that's working. Let's stick to what works. And so there you have a conflict. So I see both sides there. Let's carry on. For Mardi Gras, remaining members Stu Cook and Doug Clifford shared the writing, singing, and production duties. Fogerty contributed only three original songs and sang a fourth lead on a cover of the 1961 Ricky Nelson hit Hello Mary Lou. Which version of Mary Lou do you prefer? The 61 Ricky Nelson version or the 72 CCR version? Let me know. Clifford and Cook each wrote and sang the lead vocals on three songs. The album was a commercial success, peaking at number 12 and going gold. The album contained two top 40 singles, both of which were contributed by Fogerty. The raucous Sweet Hitchhiker and the wistful Swan Song, Someday Never Comes. He's a hit maker, man. Pure and simple. Looking at it from management, from a label's point of view, he's the hit maker. All songs were recorded in January of 72, except Door to Door and Sweet Hitchhiker, which were recorded in the spring of 71. Recording sessions for Mardi Gras were fraught with conflict. According to Cook and Clifford, it was Fogerty's ideas for all members to contribute songs equally, despite their reservations. Yeah, maybe he's stretching them out of their comfort zone. Maybe they knew that they weren't vocalists. Maybe they knew that they weren't great songwriters, not to the caliber of John. Maybe they knew that perhaps their presence singing lead might have actually hurt the brand. So maybe that's their reservations. Or just basically just pushing them in a direction where they're not comfortable. It's uncharted territory for them. Not sure what exactly it might have been for each individual member here, but it must have been quite unnerving to be pushed in that direction. They believe Fogerty was bitter over Tom Fogerty's departure and their own requests to have additional say in the group's musical decisions. Okay, so they might not have wanted to contribute musically in the sense of creating music themselves, writing music themselves, but they wanted to have a say on the direction of the overall band, the overall brand. Okay, both also believed Fogerty was looking for an excuse to break up CCR to pursue a solo career. Okay. At that point in time, John definitely knew his value in the marketplace. He knew that he had a command of creativity and that he was a hit maker. So by this point in time, he was probably very, very comfortable and very, very ready to branch out on his own. When Clifford and Cook at first demurred at the idea of having to supply 2/3 of the album's materials themselves, Fogerty threatened to quit the band outright. Fogerty also refused, Fogerty also refused to contribute any vocals or instrumentation to Cook and Clifford's songs except for guitar. Mounting financial and legal woes compounded the fragile situation, leading CCR to disband shortly after the Mardi Gras tour ended. Okay, so there are six albums in at this point, have lots and lots of success, but all the same, they are still facing financial and legal woes. It doesn't say what exactly, what specifics. If you know your CCR history, let me know about that. What was happening with them, their financial and legal woes? I figured at this point, they've probably got a ton of money and that they can go in any direction they want and that they're the kings of their castles, but maybe not if you've got financial and legal woes. Let me know about that, man. Mardi Gras was remastered on 180-gram vinyl by Analog Productions in 2006. The album was re-released in remastered format as a Japan exclusive in January of 2011. A remastered version of the album had previously been featured internationally on the 40th anniversary CCR box set, but not as a standalone album. Okay, so finally, last paragraph here is reception. Reception. Reviews were mixed to poor, and John Landau said in his May 26, 1976 review for Rolling Stone that in the future, Mardi Gras may be known as Fogerty's Revenge. Okay, right. Read that in the opening. Fogerty's Revenge. So maybe he, what he's saying is that John is saying to them, okay, you guys wanted to play a bigger role. You wanted to have more creative say. You wanted more. Well, here you go. Now you have more. And if you don't contribute a certain amount, I'm out of here. I'm done. I don't need this. So if I'm going to stay, you contribute a certain amount. Now you've got your creative input. Maybe that's where we're going with that. In 76, John Fogerty told Rolling Stone magazine, quote, "I figured that Creedence made six albums. Let me count. The first one, Bayou Country, Green River, Willie and the Poor Boys, Cosmos Factory, Pendulum. Yeah, six. I wouldn't even count Mardi Gras, and neither would anyone else. I had no control over anything after that. The rest is horse manure. Baloney." Unquote. Wow. So this was in 76. So, yeah, he was, I guess, still quite bitter over the whole situation and bitter over the album, the way it was constructed, and his lack of creative input and control. And hey, you know what? I don't blame him. I would probably feel the same way if I was the band leader and I led the band to such a high peak of success with six successful albums. And then right after that, I let some of that control go. And the result is the seventh album not being as well received and as well touted. You know, I would be a little bit crossed with that too. And I'm betting you that John is the kind of person who saw the future. He had a goal in mind. He had a goal to put CCR at the very, very top, to make the Hall of Fame, to be noted as having, being the creative force behind a band that put so many number one hits, or so many hits up there on the charts. And he knew probably that if he was to give way to a certain extent, that would be hindered by other forces in the form of other band members and whoever else had their hands mixed in there. So I can see John's point of view. I can see pretty much POV from everybody's point of view, band members I'm talking about. And it's sad in a way that they weren't able to, of course, be more cohesive. But at the end of it all, 7 albums later, they gave us some fantastic music. Even if John doesn't consider this album much of anything, Horse Manure and Baloney, they still put a couple of really, really good songs out there. And not just songs, a couple of hits from that album as well. So it's anything but Horse Manure. But I understand his point of view, man. I definitely see his point of view. So that is Wikipedia Song Fact Info on Mardi Gras, CCR's 7th and final album. I like the album. I would listen to it a number of times. I would definitely listen to the John vocals more so. But overall, you know, it is what it is. It's a good album. And if it was just to fall from the sky without any knowledge of CCR, who, what, where, and how, I would say, hey, this is a really, really great album. And I would listen to it without any kind of judgment or anything like that. In the end, though, I would probably still gravitate towards John's vocals because it's just so distinct. You know, it's just so unique. But overall, great album, man. Great album. So, I'm just going to scroll down to my notes here, man, and see what I got coming up this week. It's the beginning of a new week. I didn't feel like doing much yesterday. Heard about Kobe Bryant's passing and the sad, sad passing along with him, his daughter, his 13-year-old baby girl, man. Damn. So rest in peace to you, Kobe. Coming up this week, man, I've got, I'm going to do Centerfield. Centerfield is John's solo album. Of course, I'm going to continue with my complimentary quads. That's my New Year's resolution to stay on top of that. Along the way, I've also got a Gone Too Soon. This is for Alan, so that's coming up this week. I'm going to squeeze in a Patreon exclusive in there. And this is the time now, the 27th we're at. I'm going to start bugging you, patrons, the patrons who are silver and higher, to give me your Artist of the Month recommendation, who your recommendations are for the month of February, the coldest month in the year. So hopefully it's going to be somebody who's sizzling hot. So let me know what your recommendations are for Artist of the Month. That'll be cool, man. And so Led Zeppelin is a couple of days away. So that is my overall reaction and review of Mardi Gras. So CCR, man, has been an excellent Artist of the Month. And thank you very much for recommending CCR. And I look forward to definitely... Now, I haven't even, along the way, done any kind of live reactions to CCR. The only live reaction I've done was, I believe it was Quad, perhaps? And it was at the Woodstock Festival. And that's pretty much all that I've done. And that was a number of months ago. So it was the Woodstock anniversary. That's what it was. And I did a number of reactions throughout that anniversary. And CCR, I believe, was the last of them. But that's all that I've done where it comes to live performances. I don't even know what CCR looks like in a studio setting, like maybe they appeared on Ed Sullivan, something like that. So I've still got a little bit of discovery where CCR is concerned. And if you have some information about that, let me know, man. And I mentioned also there was a CCR biography. So if you guys have that link, let me know about that. I'll do a little bit of a search for my on my own. It's probably on YouTube, I'm sure. But yeah, man, if you have a link and you have a moment to send it to me, please do. That'd be great. So thank you very much for joining me, man. Look for Centerfield in a couple of days from now, and I'll catch you in my next, well, it's going to be John Fogerty reaction. Take care. Peace.